या द जीएफएस फाइल सिस्टम गूगल. वी आर डिस्कसिंग दिस आर्किटेक्चर नो, वी आर लर्निंग अबाउट दिस आर्किटेक्चर. सो द गूगल फाइल सिस्टम, इन दिस गूगल फाइल सिस्टम वी आर गोइंग टू सी the it, so we are going to learn about the distributed file system. So GFS is a distributed file system where your data is distributed into multiple servers. These are the chunk servers. So your file is 1 terabyte file is there. You have to store it in the multiple servers. So that file is, first of all, it's subdivided into multiple chunks, and that is stored in multiple machines. That is distributed over multiple machines. That multiple machines here it's showing as chunk servers. They are called chunk servers. Now the GFS client, it's difficult for it to identify which chunk of your file is available in which chunk server. It's quite difficult for that. What to do now? So for that reason, we have a GFS master component. So a GFS master component is arranged here. In this GFS component, GFS master component, you have details about all your data where it is stored. Okay, that is called as GFS master. It is maintaining the metadata. It's maintaining the metadata details about all your data where it is stored. That is GFS master. Okay. So here the one more component what you are seeing along with the chunk servers are GFS master. That is all maintaining details. Like when your file is subdivided into chunks and it's stored in multiple chunk servers, every chunk server is having a unique ID. So that unique ID is maintained here. That ID is maintained here. So these all chunk server, commodity servers are providing an interface for GFS client to perform read or write requests. Suppose I want to read some data. Otherwise I want to perform some write operation. I want to store some data in particular chunk server. So I will first send a request, first approach GFS master. So first I will send a file name to the GFS master. So the GFS master is going to know how many chunk servers are there in a rack and the IDs of that, how many replications are done, all the details, this metadata is GFS master is storing, what is called as metadata. So once when I send a file name, so GFS master is going to send me a response telling that some particular machines are spaces available. Like it's going to send the chunk locations where I can store my data, which chunk server I can store my data. It's sending the chunk locations where I can set. So you have so many machines. So in which machine the space is available, it's going to send me. It's going to send me the chunk locations. So therefore, the GFS client can go directly to that chunk server and can store the storage data in particular chunk servers. And one more important thing is, so there might be a possibility when there are hundreds of servers as we discussed, and they are inexpensive servers, commodity servers, there might be a possibility that one or two servers may go down. But still, there should be a fault tolerant. GFS is fault tolerant. Why? Because there is your data can be replicated. So there is a possibility of your data replications while configuring. I'll discuss how to configure data in the next class. So when you are making configuration of your HDFS, you can tell how many replications can be done. By default, the replication factor is 3. 3 places your data will be replicated. So even one of the server is down, your data is not lost. So that's the reason you are using inexpensive servers. So one place your data is lost, you can get it. But you see, this GFS master should be always highly reliable server. This is expensive servers, high reliable servers they are. Why? Because even in chunk server, if the chunk servers, the data is lost, as data is replicated, you are not losing anything. But this data should not be lost. The details where your data is stored, what are the chunk server IDs, how many places it is replicated, how many files are deleted, how many servers are down. So all this data is maintained in this GFS master. So this should be an expensive server. This is not a cheap server. This is an expensive server. Okay, so this GFS master should be a highly reliable server, but this chunk servers can be inexpensive servers. So that is what the thing is. So this is one important concept in this architecture. So these all points are there here, ma. You just read out, okay? Just read out. You will understand all that. Only I explained in that architecture diagram. So this architecture diagram is all telling about Google file system. Google file system is a distributed file system where your data is distributed in multiple machines. and that machines are commodity servers, that is inexpensive servers, and that servers are inexpensive servers. Okay, and one more important thing is, when the GFS client will send a file name to the GFS master, that is a component where your metadata is stored. That is details about your data storage, where your data is stored. So once it's sending a file name to the GFS master, GFS master will send the location where to store the data. So then the client can go and store the data in particular server. And one more important thing is, if your data is lost, even then it's not an issue. Why? Because your data is replicated in two more places. Default factor of replication is 3. Two more places it's available. So your data is, your server is down, your data is still not lost. It's available in another places also. That's one more important thing. And every and your file is subdivided into chunks. 64 MB is the size of that chunks. And your chunk ID will be a 64-bit ID. Chunk server ID is 64-bit ID. So every chunk server will be having an ID. General example also I gave for this. Like the general example is, I am a GFS client. I have 100 bags. My room capacity is very small. I can't store that 100 bags in my, okay, 100 bags in my room. My room capacity is very small. So that means 100 bags means it's a big data for me. My room capacity is 10. My room capacity is just 10. So I cannot store that 100 bags. That is big data for me. So what do? I will go to a data center. That means so general example, I'm saying, I will take some other room. And in that there are so many rooms within that 100 rooms are there, where I can place all my 100 bags easily in that 100 rooms. So what should I do? I can't go and directly place in 100 rooms. It will be difficult for me to collect my bags again. So there is a person who is maintaining all the information in that room. So he will, on paper, he will maintain how many rooms are there, room numbers are there, which rooms are vacant, all that information he is maintaining. So that is like GFS master. So that person in that room, I'll take a room for rent and I want to store my 100 bags in that 100 rooms. But I need, but what the thing is, I will store in 100 rooms. But when I have to collect the bags, I don't know which bag is in which room. So that is, that data should be there. That is metadata. So I need a person. A person will be maintaining all that information. Like 100 rooms are there, room numbers are there. Which room your bag numbers, you are sending your bag number. For every bag, I have a number. So he will be noting the bag numbers and he knows the room numbers, where he has kept the bag. So all this information that GFS master is maintaining. So which bag is kept in which room. So now what I do, I will ask him, give me my bag. So he will tell, he will ask me the bag number. So that is my file name, like GFS file name. GFS client is giving a file name. So that person is going to give me a room number. Go and collect your file, go and collect your bag from so-and-so room number. So I can go and collect easily. So likewise, GFS client is sending a file name. So GFS master is sending the location name where your file is. So then you can go and collect read or write operations. So that means you are performing read or write operations. Read operation is you fetch the data. Write operation is you can store the data in particular places. This is all about this architecture. So in this architecture, as an example, as I said, I have 100 bags. So here my data is that 100 bags. So I have 1 terabyte data. So you are splitting your data and you are storing in chunk server. So you send your file name, GFS master is going to in turn send the location name where your file is kept. So you will go and fetch your data from that particular chunk server. So that is what all about this Google file system. So this is the first topic, Google file system, GFS architecture. 64-bit chunk handle. So this is all theory, ma, for this related architecture. So I gave an explanation of the Google file system. Then I will be telling you about building blocks of HDFS. The next concept is building blocks of HDFS. So this topic, GFS, first topic is completed. The architecture you have seen and we have discussed about that. We will be learning about building blocks of Hadoop. So what are the building blocks of Hadoop? Are the main building blocks, the daemons which are running behind, the threads which are running behind are name node, data node, secondary name node, job tracker, task tracker. So we will learn about these things. Okay. So we will be learning what is name node, data node, secondary node, task tracker, and job tracker and task tracker. This is the second topic in the second unit. So let's understand this with some diagrammatic representation. I already discussed about name node and data node in the last class. Yet to discuss about the job tracker and task tracker and secondary name node. So previous class, I already discussed what is the name node and what is the data node. Once again, quickly, I will tell you what is name node and data node. Then we will move on to secondary name node, job tracker, and task tracker. So these are all, as I just told you, Hadoop is developed with Java programming, right? And we have some daemons which are running behind, threads, some programs which are running behind. That is daemon thread, data node, secondary node, job tracker, and task tracker. So these are the building blocks of Hadoop. Hadoop distributed file system. So Hadoop contains two major components. I said, no, Hadoop distributed file system. The other one is, what's the other one is? MapReduce. So first we are going to learn about HDFS and its building blocks. Hadoop distributed file system. It is a distributed file system where your data is stored in multiple servers. Again, the same commodity servers only, inexpensive servers only. So let's understand that. These are the five components, daemons, which are running in the Java program. So the name node, data node, secondary name node, job tracker, and task tracker. Let's see that. With some diagrammatic representation, we will understand that. Secondary node, I didn't tell. I already discussed about this name node. So let's learn. That name node is also called as master node. And the data nodes are called as slave nodes. Okay? And they are called as slave nodes. So there is a communication between master node and slave node always. That is through some switches, core switches. So the master node and slave node. The master nodes are nothing but your master machines, master machine, expensive machines, I said, no, highly reliable machines. They are expensive machines where all the details about your data will be stored. We have just discussed in Google file system. Same way here also, in Hadoop distributed file system also, we have a master machine, what is named as name node server. Okay, it's a machine. It's a machine where it's connected with your slave nodes, all the commodity servers. So how it's connected is with the core switches. Some equipment is there, some switches will be there. So with that switches, all these are connected with each other. That server, that master machine and the slave machines are connected by using some switches, what are called as core switches. So what is this master machine is? It is a highly reliable server. Where what this highly reliable server is doing is it's maintaining all the information of your storage of your data. Same like a Google file system only. Here it is named as name node. And these all commodity servers are named as data nodes. The name is changed. There they are calling it as chunk servers. Here we are calling it as data nodes. But what's the main difference between that distributed file system and Hadoop distributed file system is? In Hadoop distributed file system, one second, this is a diagram. So in this Hadoop distributed file system, this rack switch is there. In this, all the computers, your nodes are stored. So this is one rack like this. You have all, these are all commodity servers. These are all commodity servers. So in the distributed file system, what happened is you are storing your data in multiple servers, like rack one, rack two, rack three. This is rack one, which is having multiple servers. So rack two, these are having so many commodity servers like this. All these are interconnected. All these are connected to this master machine. This Hadoop cluster is there. No, this is master machine. So all this master machine has connection with all these rack switches. Okay. Within that, you have so many nodes, your servers, commodity servers. So here in the earlier existing system, what happened is you stored your, you distributed your file into multiple machines like this, multiple nodes. But there, what happened is you store the data, but when you have to do processing, what happened is you have pulled back all the data. You have collected all the data back to the master machine. So this is not HDFS. Assume that this is just an ordinary distributed file system. So what happened is you distributed in multiple servers, but when you have to run your program, when you have to process your data, you have pulled back all the data. So that is an overhead to network channels. So you have pulled back all the data to your main machine, your master machine, and there your data processing was done in that master machine. That centralized machine, your data processing was done. That is an overhead again. It's again taking more time only. You distributed data because your machine capacity is unable to store that much bulk data. Now, 1 petabyte data, suppose your machine is only 1 terabyte data. So what you did is you have distributed in multiple servers like this. So this diagram you see. This is rack one, this is rack two. So you distributed your data in multiple commodity servers. You store. Storage capacity, storage problem is solved, but still the processing problem is there. Why? Because you store the data as your machine capacity is beyond that. So you store the data in commodity servers. But when you have to process the data, what you have to do is you have to get back all the data to centralized machine, and there only the processing is done. In that highly reliable server, there the processing was done. So there again, it's again processing time is taking more, which is again an overhead only. It's again an overhead. So the solution to this is, what the solution in this Hadoop distributed file system is, where the data is stored, there itself the data is processed. So here itself the machine, in these machines only your data is getting processed. So that is the solution. That is what Hadoop distributed file system, difference between the distributed file system and Hadoop distributed file system. So in Hadoop distributed file system, you are not pulling back your data to the centralized machine and processing there. So where the data is stored, there itself the data is processed. So that is the main difference between the normal Google file system and the Hadoop distributed file system. So in Hadoop distributed file system, what you did is, where the data is stored, there itself the data is processed. So you are sending some logic to that place. So how that logic is sent is with MapReduce concept. That one we will be learning. How that code you are sending to these places, to these computer one, computer two, these are all servers, no? To these servers only, the data is sent. The code is sent to these places, and there the data is processed. So there itself the data is processed. So there is no point of overhead in the network. So you are reducing the network bandwidth. There is no overhead in the network bandwidth. Okay, so here itself the data is some code, some logic you are sending here. So with that logic, the processing is done in these multiple machines. So in these multiple machines, and the result is sent back to the centralized machine. So this is what Hadoop distributed file system is. Now we shall learn in detail about all that name node, data node, secondary node, job tracker, and task tracker. So this is all about introduction. What is happening in Hadoop distributed file system? So distributed the data in multiple machines, it's done like a distributed file system only. But here the thing is, processing is also done there itself. You are not pulling back to the centralized machine, and you are not increasing the overhead there. So that network bandwidth problem is solved here in the Hadoop distributed file system. And how that logic is sent, you need to send a code to these machines, so that processing is done in that machine. But how it is done, we shall learn in depth in MapReduce concept. So logic is sent to these machines. How that logic is sent, we will be learning in MapReducing program. So right now we have seen how the data is stored, and we understood that what is HDFS, Hadoop distributed file system. Let's learn in more depth about name node and data nodes. This also I said, in the last class I said this, we shall be learning now about secondary node, job tracker, and task tracker. So once again, what is this name node is? The name node is a master machine, a highly reliable machine. This is a costlier machine. Your client is storing data, storing and fetching the data. Read write operations are performed directly from these servers only. Okay, it's not, there is no point of storing at all in the name node. You are not storing anything in the name node. So your storage and your fetching the data is everything done from these data nodes only. So these are all commodity servers. Data nodes are also called as slave nodes. These are also called as slave nodes. So in that diagram, you have seen, no, rack. Rack you have seen, no? This boxes you have seen, no? Once again, I will show. Where is that diagram? This is a rack. These are nodes. So in this diagram, you are seeing the same. This architecture diagram. This is the architecture diagram. You should learn this diagram thoroughly. This is a rack. This is one rack. So many nodes are there. This is second rack. In this also, so many slave nodes are there. These are called slave nodes. Data nodes are called as slave nodes. Or they are also called as commodity servers. They are called as inexpensive servers, commodity servers. These data nodes are inexpensive servers. So here only your data is resided. Your data is stored. So this is one rack. In one rack, you have so many data nodes. In second rack, these are the data nodes in second rack. Right. So this name node is a master machine. This is a master machine where you store metadata. Same like Google file system. This is storing the metadata. Details about your data, like your ID, your data node ID, and how many replications are there, how many files you have deleted, like that. What is the file name? So all the details are maintained in the name node. And the client will first interact with the name node to get the details of your data storage. So it will find out where your data is stored. So this in response, this will send a response to this client where the data is stored. So there it will go and fetch the data. So it will go to that particular server and it will fetch the data. And you can notice here replication. The replication I'll discuss about. What is that replication is? I told you replication factor is 3. The replication factor is 3. Where is that replication? So like this. Your file is divided into multiple blocks and it is distributed over multiple nodes. So block 1 is arranged in node 1. Block 1 is kept in node 2 also. It's kept in node 4 also. So even as there are hundreds of servers, one of them might be slow. One of the server may go down, but even then your data is not lost. Suppose this node 1 is going down. The server is down, but still your data is not lost. Why? Because it's replicated in two more places. So that is what block replication is. That is what block replication is. And in this architecture, you have seen about what is metadata, what is name node, and you learned what is replication. What is this replication factor? 3 is the default replication factor. But while configuring, client can even increase the number of replication factors also. So this is, as I told, so name node is very highly available server that manages the file system namespace. And you have two more components which are programs which are running, that is FSL image and FS image, file system image and edit logs. I'll tell, when I'm discussing secondary node, I will talk more about this FS image, file system image and edit logs. Okay, when I will tell about secondary node, I'll discuss more about that. And data nodes are slave nodes, as we just discussed, data nodes are slave nodes. And functions of the data nodes is here data storage is done and it always gives an intimation to the name node. So it always, for every 3 seconds, it's always giving a response to the name node that it's still alive. That is called as heartbeat. Okay. So data node always interacts with the name node machine. So you have a connection between that main machine and your slave machines. Master machine and slave machine. Master machine is name node, slave machine is your data node. So there is always communication going on between these two. So data node always communicates with the name node. It always intimates that it is still alive. So it should know that the data node is alive or not. Why? Because it has to tell to client where the data can be stored, which locations it's free, which locations, which nodes are free, which nodes are alive. All that details name node should be maintaining. So always the data node will be sending some message to the name node for every 3 seconds that indicates that it is still alive. That is what data node is. So to tell you about this secondary node, we will discuss. I'll discuss once. Let me complete this. So your file is divided into blocks. I said, no, by default block size is 128. Whereas in our existing systems, what happened is we had just 4 KB. Our normal machines are there, no? Our PCs are there, no? Normal machines, 4 KB size only. So if suppose your text file is 2 KB, the remaining 2 KB space will be wasted. Remaining 2 KB space will be wasted. My in our ordinary machines, our capacity is 4 kb only. Suppose 2 kb is my text file. So what happened is the remaining 2 kb space will be wasted. But whereas here, 128 megabytes, default block size, your file is 514 megabytes. The default, the default block size is 120. It's splitted into 128 megabytes, splitted into 128 megabytes. So even if there is some free space, that free space will be utilized by some other file. It can be utilized by some other file. So like this, the data space is not wasted. We can use that data space. Whereas in our ordinary machines, the remaining space is wasted. But here, the data space is not wasted. So that is one important thing. Here, that explanation is given. You can see this. And it's not compulsory that it should be 128. While configuring, you can change it also. And about replication, I just told you what is replication. And about this write operation, we have discussed what is this write operation. So your file, your client is sending some write request. The name node, the master node is sending some IP address where to store your data. So it will go, direct communication is there between a client and data node, but there is no storage point of view in the name node. So it will go to that particular data node. So it's telling that data node 1, 4, 6 are available. You can go and store in that data node. It's sending the IP address. So the GFS client will go to that particular data node and will store first. It will store in the data node 1. First, it is going to store your data in the data node 1. Then the data node 1, as you know that there is a replication point here. The data node 1, what it does is that server job now to place it in some other data nodes. So it will place the data in data node 4, like for example, data node 6, like this. So it's storing in 3 places. That is replicated. And once it is stored, then it will send an acknowledgement. Data node send this machine, data node 6, it's a machine server. It will send an acknowledgement to data node 4 from where it got. That will send a message to data node 1 that was brought, that data was given from data node 1. So it will send an acknowledgement that it has stored it. And this was given by the client. So this data node 1 will send an acknowledgement back to the client that it has stored the data. So then it will send a message that write is successful. This is maintaining. So what this data node, name node is maintaining in detail, I will tell you. So this name node consists of job tracker. That is the component which is running behind. That is the program which is running behind. So how that, what in detail we will learn, what information is stored, all that. What is this file system image and what is this edit logs, all that I will be telling you in the next class. Okay. So these building blocks we'll discuss. These three nodes I'll discuss. These three components I'll discuss in the next class. What is secondary, job tracker and task tracker. So introduction I gave today. In detail we will learn, and also we will be learning about configuration in the next class. Okay, Ma. So there is only 1 minute. I will end up this class today. You can go through this. You can go through this. Any doubts are there, you can ask me tomorrow. Today I just told you what is big data analytics, and I introduced you what is HDFS and what is name node and data node. So we have learned this, and what is Google File System architecture. These concepts we have covered. Next class I will be telling you some more.